Hello. I'm Michael Morris, Yoshiko Sato's husband and partner. On behalf of Yoshiko's mother, Mrs. Chieko Sato from Japan, and my family members who are here today from Ireland, I would like to thank you for joining us to celebrate Yoshiko's life, her work, and her teaching. While we will be following the program for the most part, some friends have been added to the list while others unfortunately couldn't make it to join us here to speak. But at the end, we'll have an open mic for anybody who wishes to share their memories of Yoshiko. Afterwards, if everybody could, who joins in speaking, could please introduce themselves beforehand as we're taping this to share with Yoshiko's family in Japan. We're also hosting a more joyous occasion at the 400 level in the exhibition, where I've mounted a small exhibition of Yoshiko's work. First of all, I'd like to begin by thanking the people who've given me the opportunity to be here today and to share this memorial event and exhibition with you. A thank you, a special thanks goes to Natalie Pfizer, our dearest friend. Sorry. But specifically here at Columbia, I'd like to thank Dean Mark Wigley for his generosity in allowing us to share today's event, and for his kind words for Yoshiko in the exhibition and in the program. I would also like to thank Dean David Hinkle for his warmth and friendship to Yoshiko and his gentle dedication and patience with everything regarding today. Thank you also to Lori Hawkinson and her boundless support of Yoshiko. Lori brought Yoshiko up here to Columbia 14 years ago, and she and Henry Smith Miller gave Yoshiko her first architecture job 28 years ago. I would like to thank Michael Bell for his collegiality to Yoshiko and to all of Yoshiko's colleagues, friends, and students here at the GSAPP. I'd also like to thank the incomparable colleague, human being, and friend, Craig Connick, for his enthusiastically taking over to teach Yoshiko's studio, the space studio, with me. I'd also like to thank Yoshiko's former TAs and students, Kelsey Lentz and Christina Cardiolo, for everything that they did for me this semester and for the class. I'd also like to thank the Space Studio 6 students in particular for being so patient with me and for allowing me to fulfill Yoshiko's wish to complete her studio with you. I'd like to thank Pai Pilicek for hosting our class again at NASA this year and enable us to enjoy the fantastic experience that Yoshiko so wanted us all to have. Yoshiko loved teaching here so very much. She was so proud of her students' accomplishments each and every semester. From day one, Yoshiko and I, almost 28 years ago, did almost everything together, except teaching here at the GSAPP was something that she did entirely on her own. This was her place, and it was something she could never give up. Being here gave her the strength and hope right up until her last days. She was so determined to be right back here at work with you. Unlike myself at this moment, she was so profoundly optimistic, and we were all convinced that it was only a matter of time that she would be back up and back here. There are so many things that I would like to share with you about Yoshiko that you may not know and you probably would be quite amused by. How mischievous and fun-loving she really was. How she was her high school tennis champion and obsessive about watching sports. You could forget about doing anything with her during the baseball playoffs or the tennis slams in particular. How she excelled in almost everything that she put her hand to, with the exception of driving, where she couldn't take a left-hand turn without having a head-on collision. She was an accomplished pianist, an excellent cook, and a big-time shopper. Yoshiko loved to stay out all night dancing. She would have been embarrassed by today's focus on her, as she was uncomfortable with public praise not associated with accomplishments of hard work. She preferred to earn every stripe that she received. I think she would be quite happy with us celebrating her here today, but perhaps not so much at me on the account of my exposing her age, which is something she almost never revealed to anyone, even at the loss of publication where it was a requirement, she said no. For the record, I have to correct the record. She just turned 51, not 52, but you knew her all to be of 35. I wanted to share a little story that Yoshiko privately told me and perhaps a few intimates that she regarded as her greatest achievement as an architect, and which I believe may shed a little light on who and what Yoshiko cared about most in regards to her perfectionism, and perhaps explains why she was such a caring yet disciplined teacher with her students. A number of years ago, we were given an opportunity to design a retrospective exhibition for Shiro Kuramata at the Gray Art Gallery downtown. The assignment at the Gray Gallery was a difficult and stressful one because it was a first among many complicated issues and reasons, and yet somehow we prevailed in making it a success, and ultimately we received quite a fair amount of international recognition in the press and awards for our work there. But as Yoshiko told it, one day during the exhibit run, she was in the closed gallery space alone, fussing over some detail or another, as she and I were bound to do, when an elderly janitor came in and asked her, "Little lady, did you have something to do with this exhibit?" To which Yoshiko replied, "Yes, I designed it." And the janitor said, "Well, I want to tell you something, that I've been sweeping these floors of this gallery for more than 20 years, and this is the first show that I want to bring my wife to see." Sharing her work together with this proud man brought Yoshiko immense joy. Thank you.
Thank you. I met Yoshiko at Parsons when she was a student in one of the first classes of design at the newly formed School of Environmental Design there. She was a member of a fierce class of students. I just graduated from Cooper myself and was a member of the Parsons design faculty with Billy Tien, Peter Wilwright, Ross Anderson, and it was a very exciting time. And as Michael mentioned, for a short time, Yoshiko worked in our office with Henry and I. I had no idea that was her first job. She was so accomplished, always. She had come from Japan to study design, but she arrived already fully formed and a very confident designer. I distinctly remember an amazing studio project she did for a rooftop building in Manhattan. And you have to realize this was when everyone was starting their practices, and we were experimenting with design and installation and loft interior. So there were no large-scale urban projects or competitions. We were focusing really on the small scale. Yoshiko created the most thoughtful and precise physical models of all of her projects. And I can recall her describing a project with an absolutely clear intelligence. And remember that English was not her first language. Pointing to a very small and perfectly constructed areas of her model and describing what was going on and listening to her, you could realize and visualize everything she was describing. We were all mesmerized by her insight and brilliance. The cardboard in her hands became a kind of shorthand for her ideas. She also drew like an angel. It's interesting to see, and if you haven't seen them yet, you will upstairs, her wonderful models in the exhibition, and to be reminded of her remarkable and unique authorship. Yoshiko transformed common cardboard into vital and magical projections of her uncommon ideas. From analog to digital, she had an extraordinary talent for design. She had a command and intensity to her work from the get-go. It's not just interesting, but it's understandable that she was able to transfer her skills into new techniques for manipulating materials like Corian and light with this amazing intelligence and facility. In all cases, her ideas were so clear and almost floating in the air in front of you. Whether she designed a strange light fixture that you also sat on, a wall that glows, an entire urban concept, or design ideas for our occupation of outer space. I'd also like to say that she had a wicked sense of humor, which always made it so fun to be in her company. She will be missed.
Good afternoon. My name is Toshiko Mori. I've known Yoshiko as one of the most talented students, the most dedicated and effective teachers, and an original architect of an exceptional caliber for nearly 30 years. She left us fantastic memories, funny, humorous, as Laurie and Michael said, and fascinating body of work. Her productivity and diligence and work ethic were so well known, yet encountering it yet again renews our amazement at her thoughtful craftiness and craftsmanship and clarity of her vision. Her body of work is a gift to all of us because this is where we can start to live our life with Yoshiko again, this time in our imagination. We received very sad news from Michael in early February. For many of us, it was shocking news, a tragedy, a traumatic loss of someone who's beautiful, ageless, and timeless. We do not associate with Yoshiko the notion of mortality. Sometimes in life, a disappearance of a person haunts us our waking and sleeping hours. As the days, weeks, and months go by, it seems to me that her memories become more vivid. She starts to inhabit our inner life so that we can conduct a dialogue in a way we were not able to do while she was on Earth with us. It can span time and space, past and future. In particular, I wanted to understand her interest in outer space in the increase in intensity of her research, especially through her studios here at Columbia with her students in recent years. In retrospect, I wondered if she was interested in the question of the origin of life, understanding of larger questions of life on Earth, as she was confronting her illness. In her research of astronomy and sciences related to planets and stars, I was thinking she might have perhaps arrived at a revelation. Yoshiko has always been like this. She has a precise and analytical mind, and she has a rigorous and disciplined methodology to synthesize multiple disciplines through her strong emotional, ethical, and spiritual constitution. She demonstrated this to us over and over again through her work, thinking and teaching. Her observations and revelations are clear and inspired. I started to reread The Life of Super Earth, a recent publication by my friend and colleague, Dimitar Sasilov, professor of astronomy at Harvard, and the founder and the director of Harvard Origin of Life Institute. It's a strange thing to do, to read technical astronomy book, to relieve the pain of loss of my friend, but here I was. In it, Dimitar Sasilov states that life is a planetary phenomenon, and that life is transplantable, and that life is sufficiently powerful to transport itself from Earth to the moon. I thought that is Yoshiko. But I was admonishing, chastising myself. In pure lament, I was mixing science with New Age ideas, but I needed consolations. Well, this morning I was walking to my studio thinking I have to write this out. I really didn't want to speak. I wanted to remain in silence, thinking about her. But through bright morning sunlight, lo and behold, who do I see but Dimitar Sasilov himself with his wife, who are usually in Cambridge. So I say good morning, Dimitar, and ask him while they are waiting for a table of basada for their brunch. And while they are sitting on a bench outside, if you know what I mean, and that I've been reading his book again and struggling with a philosophical question in dealing with a death of my friend, an architect, who had a deep interest in outer space. I asked how we should interpret his book as it applies to transformation in our understanding of life and its place in the cosmos. Well, this is a heavy question on Sunday morning, but Dimitar is a Russian. He loves it. He can't never have enough of this. He just dive into it. So, and also I said to Dimitar, I suspect there may be a paradigm shift in thinking about life in relationship to Earth. I also told him it's important to me because I think this friend, Yoshiko Sato, was onto something significant. Dimitar said, of course I did not state life as on Earth, but it is of Earth. I stated biology is a future of astronomy. It is about life. We become particles and continue to participate in search of life on the universe. So I asked him, is my mixing spirituality and astronomy a silly sentimental gesture? He said, but no, everyone is onto it, those who are astute, that the idea of continuity of life in outer space is all coming together in sciences, humanities, and the arts in our time. All of a sudden, I recall Yoshiko's sense of humor, her wit, her mischievous manners, her girlish gestures and smiles. I can just see her laughing uncontrollably because she knew this answer all along. This was amazing orbital collision. Dimitar says astronomical chances with you and I encountering in space and time talking about this is quite amazing. I think Yoshiko made this encounter happen for me to give me answers in this beautiful morning of the day of her memorial.
Hello, I am Diana Agrest. I'm a professor at Cooper Union, and Yoshiko was my student in 1978. That's a long time ago. When I met Yoshiko, I was teaching a small group, so we had very direct relationship. It wasn't a big class. And truly, I can't remember what the assignment was, but I have this vision, and this is what I want to share with you. Yoshiko came with a 6-foot-long vellum, which is the worst thing to work on. It was about 30 inches high, and it had one line. And at the end of this line was a little wiggle. And she said she was working with the work of a contemporary Japanese musician. And maybe something like that hit it off with for me, because of course all my life I had been involved in contemporary music and nothing. But more than that, it was the line. This line, I'd never seen a line like that, ever, nor have I seen it since. This line was, to put in musical terms, like if Japanese extraordinary pianist Mitsuko Uchida would play the piano. You have it or you don't. And Yoshiko did have it, together with an extraordinary mind. And when I first, in surprise, that she was using this referent, she might have thought that I was opposing her or something. So it was very interesting. Here you have this very apparently unassuming person, but completely defiant. And that immediately sealed it for me. And although we were not friends in the sense that we kept in touch constantly, and my colleagues and friends here know a lot more about her that I'm learning now than I did, we formed a very deep and strong bond during all these years. And I was in shock to hear this most sad news. I hadn't known anything that was going on, and I'm really sorry I couldn't have been there to help her in some form of way. And I want to tell, as a last thing, that all these years in 78, every class of students I had to put up with me telling the story about Yoshiko's line. And every student in that group tried to imitate her to no avail. We'll miss you, Yoshiko.
My name is Jorge Salgado. I was Yoshiko's student in my second course studio here in the spring of 2003. She was slight and soft-spoken studio critic, but to me and my classmates, she was intimidating. I wasn't always so clear what she expected of us, but she had an innate ability to make you want to impress her. Despite my uncertainty about what she expected from me, something just clicked between us. I was inspired, and she helped me produce work I'm very proud of, and probably the best work I created when I was here. After that semester, she asked me to be her TA for a few later studios, and after graduating, I sought her advice in finding an office to work for. She said, "Why don't you work for me?" I went for my interview, and there I met Michael and Sola. That afternoon, I was also introduced to a Yoshiko I hadn't known. In studio, she was the quietly cool Japanese critic with an awesome wardrobe. But that day, I saw a girl living in an East Village townhouse with her husband and a big, playful red Labrador. They told me they were working on a pair of houses on Shelter Island and were looking for a project architect. It was perfect. So I spent 5 years working with Michael and Yoshiko, and I got to know them intimately. We worked on several fantastic projects, traveled together, and made countless visits to the building site on Shelter Island, obsessing over every construction detail. The office was casual, but it wasn't always easy. She was a demanding boss. When Michael and I were chatting or arguing for too long, she would always remind us, "Get back to work." She was, however, very thoughtful. On special occasions like a colleague's farewell or a birthday, Yoshiko would always surprise you with chocolates, pastries, and red wine. And sometimes, at first to my horror, and later it was fun, office karaoke. And she was really good. She was passionate about and dedicated to teaching and designing for a world that needed healing. On the surface, her world is beautifully sleek, often difficult to build, but in experience of space designed by Yoshiko, her deep understanding of the human condition and her desire to address it became evident. I think her efforts to heal through design are most clearly manifest in light showers. Although it was commissioned as an art installation, it was conceived as a space that functioned as a medical therapeutic device. Yoshiko designed it to regulate a user's biological rhythms in order to help restore and maintain health, and hoping that perhaps someday in the future, it might help someone like her. In all her work, she was intent on finessing the smallest details, the soft articulation of the point of contact between one hand and a cabinet door, the precise ergonomics of operating a sink you can fold away with the push of a button, or using just the right shade of white. Her life was a gift to those of us who were fortunate to know her. To me, she was a great mentor, a friend, and I'll always be indebted to her for her influence.
Michael Moran. Yoshiko is a verbal minimalist, as most of you knew. I often wondered if she spoke in complete sentences in Japanese, and I always doubted it. I'd met Michael and Yoshiko before, but I really got to know them on our first shoot together. It was a loft in Tribeca that I was shooting for Architectural Digest. Yoshiko would say, could we have the next slide? Do I have a clicker here? Thank you. Yoshiko would say, bedroom next. And I would set up the shot and take a Polaroid. I'd show her the Polaroid, and since she wasn't saying much, I would fill up the empty space with my elaborate reasons for the composition. She would say, yes, but maybe. She would do that. And of course, she would be right. That went on for about an hour before I realized that resistance was futile, and I surrendered myself to Yoshiko. As you look at these photographs, think about Yoshiko saying three perfect words that are just the right thing for the photograph. I'd like to talk about three very, very creative people who all died too soon. When she was young, Yoshiko was an intern in the studio Shiro Kuramata, and she became a muse for him. Her work looks nothing like his, but the spiritual connection is obvious. Michael and Yoshiko designed an exhibition on the work of Kuramata at the Gray Art Gallery, which traveled to the Musée des Arts Décoratifs in Montreal. Herbert Muchamp had promised to write a review for the Times. Even though he was very sick at the time, he wrote what I think was one of his best reviews ever. I love the first line. It could be Yoshiko's epitaph. I'll read a few excerpts. Find this button. There we go. Okay. Somewhere there's music. At the Gray Art Gallery and Study Center on Washington Square, to be precise, where a beautiful show of work by the Japanese designer Shiro Kuramata is now on view. Kuramata, who died in 1991 at age 56, brought to design a great song stylist emotional range. A chair can look like misty roses, too soft to touch, too lovely to leave alone. A double bed croons that two people will never be lovers, ever friends. A table sings the blues to the chair that double-crossed it. He consistently made the point that there are no limits to the ideas that design can express. Like the architecture of Arata Isosaki in the fashions of Isemeyaki, Kuramata's diverse idiosyncratic work challenges the Western view of Japan as a nation of rigid conformists. I'm sorry, this is on automatic, and I don't know how to get it off, but anyway, you'll get several views of them. No designer could ask for a better presentation than that mounted at Gray Art Gallery. The work is arranged chronologically in wide open spaces that enable viewers to identify common themes. Kuramata used to say that his work dealt more with shadow than with light. The installation designed by Moro Sato Studio in New York is gorgeously shadowed with floating platforms, subtle recesses, and occasional theatrical flair. The show makes a persuasive case that there is such a thing as aura, an energy field that surrounds some artists, not deluded by their lesser achievements and surpassing even the best ones as a force for slapping a culture into awareness. Modern architects were not the only ones who sought to release the art object's hold on creative energy. Some of this century's most important art movements, futurism, surrealism, Dada, were driven by the romantic idea that energy is pure delight. With Kuramata, the aura arises in part from his premature death and from the disappearance of his interior designs. His furniture pieces occupy the place of memory even as you're looking at them. Somehow, Kuramata eluded the postmodern fate of allowing the ideal of memory to be crushed by specific history. Perhaps he instinctively recognized that history and memory are often at odds, and that an artist's business is to bring history alive by rejecting all external authority and pursuing the unknown. Thank you. Hello, I'm William Min King, and my wife and I, Diana, got to know Yoshiko originally through this wonderful project they did for Corian, which was sort of perfect, I think, for her and Michael, because it was a kind of complete design. But we fortunately were able to get to know them better at their house on Shelter Island, and we got to see that she believed in this kind of total design, but she gave in this really kind of wonderful way. Like, I assume all of us, we had no idea that she was ill, but we spent New Year's Eve with her and Michael in their house on Shelter Island. And she sat for most of the evening, and Dan and I talked about it when we left. In retrospect, she was, I think, very weak at that moment, but we didn't know that. But it was wonderful for us to sit there and see her surrounded by this beautiful, beautiful house that she had built, looking out over the landscape. And we shared food with her, which was another way that she gave. We had long conversations about shizu and fish heads and this incredible rice that she made, which she worked at for hours, and she was always trying to explain to me how to make it. I think I never quite got it. but I think Diana has some other really fun memories of her, since we always spent time together with her and Michael at their house in Shelter Island.
Hi, these are in no certain order. I don't know Yoshiko as a teacher or being here at Columbia, but I know her as a wife, a homeowner, a gracious hostess, through Michael, through Mama Soto, through Noriko. She was beautiful, simplicity, the dogs, construction, design, shizu rice, beach picnics, ferry rides, New Year's Eve, open houses, baked fish heads, Japan. Like Bill said, we met them only a couple of years ago, and after we ran editorial on their Shelter Island houses, and we bonded over having these East End locales, and for the past few years spent many holidays and summer evenings sharing food, drink, and friendship. Never knowing what was on the horizon for Yoshiko, she graciously took in a motley crew of friends and family, whether landing on her doorstep during a winter blizzard or banging pots and pans on New Year's Eve. She and Michael were game for all of our North Fork adventures. They became extended family for us, and we for them, spending many holiday dinners and beautiful summer evenings together. I would like to think that this unexpected timing of our friendship brought a little happiness to Yoshiko's final years. I know it certainly did for us and our family.
Hi, I'm Sharon Haar. I neither taught Yoshiko, nor did I teach with her, nor was I a student of hers. In fact, I got to get to know Yoshiko when we hired Michael at Parsons in the early 90s to teach a studio. And I think within the first week or two, also got to know Yoshiko because I was so welcomed into their circle of friends and fun and architecture and experimentation and exploration and excitement about our work. When we were all sort of a little bit overly serious and about ourselves and our work, and also trying not to let anyone know that we were still not quite sure exactly what we were doing. And when I started to look at some of the work of Morris Sato over the last number of years, I've been away from New York for 15 years, and wanted to remind myself of that vast quantity of work, I started to look at certain motifs and ideas and was reminded about perhaps one of what might have been their very earliest works, which was the redesign of the offices at Parsons in 1994. when they with a budget of about $500 probably, and a staff of I don't know what, managed to mold and meld a very nasty space into a wonderful space of light and shadow and projection. And accompanying the opening of that space, we ran a show in our little gallery called Projecting Shadows, Casting Impressions. And when I was thinking about the title of that show, it not only so well captures the one or two really careful and intelligent moves that they were able to pull off, but it also captures, I think, the ideas and work that then was projected forward from that period in time. Yoshiko came to Chicago in December, I think, of 2010. I think maybe the first time in Chicago. People never come to visit me. I have to come back here to see them. She didn't have a lot of time. We had a couple of hours together, and I asked her what one piece of architecture she wanted to see. And she asked how far Unity Temple might be from where I live in the city. And I said, about half an hour's drive, let's go. I'm not a huge Frank Lloyd Wright fan. It's not a good thing to not like Frank Lloyd Wright and live in Chicago, but I don't really much. But I do love Unity Temple. In fact, I try to bring everybody to Unity Temple. I bring all my students there. I brought my parents there. I bring any architect who comes to visit there. I never get tired of Unity Temple. And of course, it was the perfect place to go with Yoshiko. It's a space that's full of light and color, that is full of incredible spatial complexity with actually a number of seemingly very simple moves. It's a space that's really very difficult to capture in photographs and that you have to be inside of. It's very small and intimate space. And when I was thinking about our going there together and just sitting inside of there, and it's kind of an overcast early winter day, the fact that the light was still coming in and the color was still surrounding us, and of course the ceiling was falling down and needed a lot of work, as it always does, I was reminded of another show that we sponsored at Parsons. I think it was never actually in our galleries, but we sent to the Rietveld Academy. We did an exchange of shows with them. And this was a show that Michael and Yoshiko put together called Boxing Light. And in thinking about Boxing Light in, again, the mid-90s, and our trip to Unity Temple, I realized how incredibly continuous the ideas were in the work and how ongoing and rethinking and how so many simple but deep, beautiful ideas and details had been present from the beginning and carried on through the future, into the future, through the presence of not only our memories but also of the work which still exists. And then I just want to say one last word of thanks to Yoshiko. I did not know she was ill, as many people did not, but she did something for me recently that I will never forget. I was in New York over last Thanksgiving and held a little book signing party for my own little celebration of my accomplishment, and invited a number of friends from New York, including Michael and Yoshiko. And the afternoon of before that party began, I called Michael to find out if they would be coming, and he said that he would be coming. Yoshiko is a little bit under the weather and might not be joining him. But when I opened the door to the loft, they both entered with Yoshiko's mother, which was really, truly amazing. And we sat together for a couple of hours and talked about my work and talked about what everyone was doing and gossiped about various things, because we like to do that. And then everyone left, and then I received a number of emails one morning in early February telling me of Yoshiko's passing. And I sat down in my apartment in the middle of winter in Chicago and could only thank her for the gift that she gave me of spending those last hours with me and for giving me her presence in those final months, and for allowing me to have one final celebration with her, one final party, which was so important to our friendship for these many years.
Hi, my name is Shile Javeri. I'm an old friend of Yoshiko's. We've been friends for nearly 30 years, I imagine. Michael and I met Yoshiko soon after I met Michael, and we shared a lot of things in common. The first and the most important thing being our friendship. I've always loved that quote that says, fine friendship requires duration rather than fitful intensity. And I kind of think that that's what our friendship was like. It was on a slow simmer for 30 years. We also shared a lot of other friends. People came in and out of our lives. We shared them together. We had a Rolodex of, realtors and attorneys and astrologers and acupuncturists that we shared with each other. We shared our pets. We shared our homes. We traveled together in the Cape and the Hamptons and in India. We shared our professions just a little bit. Mara Sato Studio designed my beautiful sun-filled office studio, which I still delight in. And she would occasionally buy my jewelry and would wear it, which I would always delight in. She'd always show it off to me. They inspired me so much, and I say they because they're a team, but Yoshiko, of course. I was always, even as a student and then beyond that, so overwhelmed by the courage of their conviction that they would stand for what they believed in. It didn't matter if they fell flat along the way. They really, really believed in something, and how could that not be inspirational to any student? I can imagine why they are inspirational to students. I think more than that, for me, as we watched her not well over the years and die gracefully, was the lesson of how powerful and quiet and still she stood as that happened. And I guess that would be the lesson that I will take. I'm getting emotional, my goodness. As our friends leave us and as our bodies fail, as they must, I think that really is the more powerful lesson than any schoolroom lesson. Maybe on a more humorous note, I think a couple of you have mentioned how funny she was, and I think that will be the one thing I will miss the most, how much we laughed together. And we laughed at her, or I should say with her. My partner Mark and I would make fun of her, and she loved it. She would love to be made fun of. We had nicknames for her. We called her Princess One, because it had to be her way. I was Princess Two, because my way was not as important. And we called her, there were so many funny names we had at her. But I think that was the lesson too, that she didn't take it so seriously. It was kind of a joke in its own way. Nothing was that serious. It was irreverent. We all fall down along the way, and you laugh at yourself. What else can you do? If there was one incident or anecdote that I can share that encapsulates what I thought of her best, we were traveling in India, and I think this Michael was catatonic and with the cars, and you know, some of you have been there, know what that's like. You're almost dying along the highways. And this is Yoshiko in 2000 in front of the Taj Mahal. And the rest of us were dressed like tourists in our, you know, bright green t-shirts and sweaters and hats and goggles and God knows what else a tourist wears. And I remember thinking when Yoshiko came out, she had planned her outfit. It was this diaphanous, white, billowy, you know, robe, because it was meant to complement the Taj Mahal. And I thought to myself, isn't that remarkable? I mean, it was something that maybe Mumtaz Mahal would wear in the court of Shah Jahan. But what was so beautiful about it was that it mattered. It mattered even if nobody saw her, or we didn't take a photograph, that she had planned the outfit to be at the Taj Mahal that day. And guess what? We can look at her, and she kind of was right. So thank you. Thanks, Yoshiko.
Hello, I'm Betsy Pierce. My husband and I met Michael and Yoshiko, must have been 14 years ago. And that apartment that you saw with Michael Moran's photograph is actually our apartment. When we first met Michael and Yoshiko, we were so overwhelmed with how professional and steady and wise. And what I hadn't expected was that the whole process of developing that space would be so fun and so funny. So many ideas came out of brainstorming sessions, scribbling on napkins, and there was nothing that you couldn't say that was too ridiculous to be an idea for the loft. And what Yoshiko came up with, obviously both of them, was the one thing that I liked the best that didn't show in the photos was in the very far back part of the loft, the shower was right in the middle of the room. In fact, you could see all the way out those front windows standing in the shower if you wanted it to. And it was pouring straight down in the shower. And the one thing that got vetoed, I tried really hard, but Yoshiko, with her good taste, finally said there's no disco ball on top of the shower. And talking about the project later, they had put in absolutely beautiful slate tiles all around the shower. And Yoshiko tells me later, well, it's like an outdoor Japanese garden. And for all that silliness was such beauty and grace, which was her way of making something just spectacular. Working with her was such a joy every single day. They became like family, and really up till now, Michael is just so close to us, and together we will all very much miss Yoshiko. At the end of the project, she was talking about it, and we hadn't realized until then that that was their first loft project. And there was so much technical brilliance, aside from the subtlety. And Makosha, no, this was our first. In fact, so much of it was totally experimental. And that's the Yoshiko that I know and miss and will love forever. And I live in her space every single day.
I'm Lauren Kogod. Yoshiko and I were in Cambridge together at the same time in the mid-90s when she was doing her MArch and I was doing doctoral work, and we were both fish out of water in the sense that we had both been adults for a while and then found ourselves as students again without our partners and husbands who were in New York, and being students rather than teachers, which we had both been. Previously, and so we spent a lot of time together when we were in Cambridge for those couple of years. She was there for three semesters, and I was there quite a bit longer. So my relationship with Yoshiko was actually very private and very one-on-one. I would say I barely know Michael at all. So one thing that has been mentioned and is just simply her quality of, I mean, you said princess, but she always seemed very much to be very regal, like a kind of a secret queen. And it didn't really matter to her whether you noticed it or not, because it was really just something that was inside her own sense of herself, her confidence in what she was capable of, her ability to live up to her own ideals, which so few of us have. One thing that I found really striking, really, really telling, I think in retrospect, and in the Kuramata exhibit, is the glass chair installation, and that's something that continually impresses me, that you would think that someone would want to show the chair. And with the choice to project the surface of the ocean onto it and through it, both on the floor and on the wall behind it, in this dark corner, it's actually quite hard to see the chair, that the glass chair disappears, and that this is not showing the chair, but rather explaining the chair, and that you have to sense it through some other kind of apparatus. And I think that this is something that's very, very telling. And I will just then mention this one anecdote that, again, was just between Yoshiko and myself. We were at the, I figured out what it was. It was the Guggenheim Soho had been where the Prada store is now. There was a gallery there, and we were looking at some work together. And one object that we saw was this amazing object was a sweater. It's a turtleneck sweater. But instead of one turtleneck, there were two turtlenecks on this sweater. And we were, you know, walking around and looking at the work, and Yoshiko stopped. And it wasn't handmade. It was somehow, someone had, you know, made a pattern, it was machine made. She stopped and she looked at it and she said to herself, "Siamese twins share one soul or have two souls?" No, each have one soul. And, you know, she kind of worked it out for herself. And so this object, which, you know, in and of itself was charming, she had made it so much more powerful by not imbuing it with the soul, but discovering that it had two souls, perhaps. And this, you know, kind of internal struggle was just really, really extraordinary. And I think that in a sense, it seemed to me that she was a kind of a spy that way, because she was always picking up information and always knew that there was something that she could learn from you. And that she was always gathering and gathering and collecting information and seeing these invisible things that were so extraordinary.
Hi, I'm Stacy Hollander. I'm the curator at the American Folk Art Museum. I knew that we were all going to say similar things about Yoshiko today, and I thought that was because she was so clear about who she was. And I figured that we would all use different words, but that many of the words would be the same: brilliance, clarity, precision, light, strength, grace. I first met Michael and Yoshiko when we were interviewing designers to work on the inaugural exhibitions at the beautiful building that Todd and Billy designed for the American Folk Art Museum. And the commission didn't go to them at the time, but we never forgot the work that they showed to us. So when there was an opportunity a few years later, we invited Michael and Yoshiko to design a baseball exhibition, and now I know why she enjoyed it so much. We didn't know what a trip it was going to be to work with them and how much fun we were going to have, because as most of you know, they had quite the routine going. And they were both brilliant, but Michael would be talking a mile a minute, and he'd be going off on all these crazy tangents, and he'd be circling round and round and round. The hands would be flying, the eyes would be darting, and before he came home again. And Yoshiko would just stand there or sit there, and she'd look, and she'd wait, and she'd wait, and she'd look. And then at some point, she would just very quietly say, "Michael." So working with gifted designers is a privilege, and it's always a learning experience. From Yoshiko, I learned about the quality of light and the lightness of being. I learned about transparency and precision. I learned about the volume that forms as a palpable force between placed objects. And I loved that Yoshiko and Michael immersed themselves so deeply into each project with such uninhibited passion and intellectual desire to understand the meaning of the idea, the words, and the objects, so that their work and the curatorial work were in perfect harmony. And it didn't matter whether it was a tiny, jewel-like exhibition or a large and ambitious show. As a curator, I have my own strong ideas about how things should be. And when Yoshiko and I rarely, I must say, disagreed, she wouldn't say it in so many words as we have heard before. She would say it in very few words. She might even say it in one word and an inflection. She might just say, "Really?" Yoshiko was a pure soul, but she was not precious. She had a sense of personal and creative conviction that is rare and that, frankly, I was quite envious of. I thought, how wonderful to go through life without self-doubt. But now I wonder whether she really did feel that way. I don't know, because she was very private. But what a wonderful face she gave us with those dark and luminous eyes that saw the world differently. Her mind was original. It wasn't bound by our gravity. She was able to balance the limits of our universe with a deep-seated belief that there was so much more.
Hi, I'm Liz Lawson. I'm both friend and colleague of Yoshiko's. I'm the business development manager at DuPont Building Innovations, which is best known for its Corian brand. I'm really honored to be able to say a few words about my relationship with Yoshiko, which, like her creations, was shaped through her love of Corian. And thank you, Michael, for gathering us here today to reflect on her legacy. Over the past 6 years, I had the pleasure to work with Yoshiko on a variety of projects. I enjoyed looking back at the portfolio of work we did together, at the finished products, the design renderings, the press releases, and even a few napkin sketches shared over a meal. And as I reviewed the body of work, I found myself becoming inspired all over again. And several themes jumped out at me: well-being, energy, sanctuary, light, and space. Whether she designed an operating room of the future, built a Corian design studio, or an industry exhibition, her striking, radiant perspectives helped heal the world through design. She brought her passion of creating positive, inspirational, healing environments to every aspect of her work, making her mark, truly caring about how people are treated in healthcare environments. I always enjoyed working with Yoshiko. I think it was in part because of her confidence and quiet inner strength. Yoshiko never needed to do much to convince me that her design ideas were good. She could easily sell me on her ideas because she was right, always so on target. And her commitment to each project, not just in the design phase, but all the way through the execution phase, was extraordinary. When working with Yoshiko, she did more than develop projects. She created experiences. And our first chance to work together was on an exhibition she and Michael originally created for the Delaware Center for the Contemporary Arts called Light Showers. Light Showers was an award-winning installation that traveled the world, a seating area where visitors experienced projections of water on the floor, which activated light pulsing around them, matching a person's breath while resting. Yoshiko shared this comment about Light Showers: viewing or sitting is not a passive condition, but a spatial state of repose, calming the human pulse, allowing the mind to empty, an aspiration to conjure nothing. The use of light and water is intended to be refreshing and renewing, magical and wondrous. I think these last words characterize Yoshiko nicely: always refreshing, constantly renewing, magical and wondrous.
My name is Michael Bell. I've stood here many times. I teach here, but never like this. There's a secret to Columbia that I think a lot of people don't know, and that despite all the ambition and all the struggles and all the drive to do inventive things, it's really held together by an incredible bond of people. And I always tell people to network. It's and that fits the probably some of the theoretical ideas for the school in terms of architecture. But people talk every day, and we have a curriculum, it's real, but we really talk. We just talk and we talk and we talk, and we email and we call. And I have a just incredible role in the school over these 10 or 12 years because I direct what's called Core Studios, and I always tell people you really don't direct anything, you just try to get these brilliant people to talk to each other and grow together. So I had this incredible experience of Laurie Hawkinson telling me Yoshiko Sato is going to join the school and you should get to know her because she knows all about housing and you work on housing. So here's where it gets funny. I called her and I can't remember exactly how, but we went to the Cooper Hewitt to see a show that she and Michael had designed. And I thought I would have a little 30-minute tour of the show to learn about Yoshiko so I could work with her better and understand how I could help mobilize, and I could be mobilized by what she knows. But what I got was about an 8-hour tour of the show. And I quickly realized that she was testing me to see if I could focus and if I would live up to her idea of what things should be. So I learned about the kick plates and I learned about, we went step by step by step by step. And I was exhausted, but I came out of there thinking, this is an unbelievable person and this is an unbelievable architect. And instead of being curious, like, how do you get a show at the thing at the Cooper Hewitt? I just couldn't believe the rigor and the humor, because she really was testing me. Later on, when she was doing the house on Shelter Island with Michael, which they're still doing, I called her up. I said, you know, I really want to see your house. And she said, yes, come over. I went with Injong, my wife, who's an architect also, and we had about a 3-hour lunch that was completely organic before we were allowed to then have the 8-hour tour. And I thought, wow, lunch is already taking the whole day, and I haven't even seen the house. And I'm glad Jorge explained to me where that obsession comes from, because I was shocking the sheer genius of execution, but also Yoshiko's complete profound understanding of space, lowering a window to change your gaze so that you saw the earth shaping a rise in the middle so that your eyes would go up, and just this unbelievable sense of space and confidence, and then the ability to have the toughness and the courage to actually do the project. And that's what I saw in both of them, because it takes immense courage to do these things. It's money, it's power, it's people, it's risk. But she did it so gracefully. And like Bill and Diana, we were at that house and I had no idea she was sick, and felt like I couldn't believe that experience happened. Another thing about Columbia, the stairway is everything. If you go up through the building, it's about, to go from the subway to the studios is about 7 floors. And it keeps people healthy, I think. But on the stairways, what I remember is I always saw Yoshiko. She always spun around and she always smiled at me, and she always gave me a smile like, come on, we can do this. And always, just always. And I know she was busy. I often had her students. They would come from her class and then seemed to me often into mine. This can't be true, but I was once told that you had to have a hall pass to go to the bathroom from her class. And I was telling David Hinkle this, but I think what it really meant was that she said studio was important and 2 to 6 was real, and when you went in there, you were supposed to focus. That's the way undergraduate was for me, but frankly, in graduate school, we forget that all the time. So I don't know if there's really a hall pass needed, but being in that class really mattered, and I felt immense responsibility to be a good teacher, because I knew these kids knew what a great teacher and a great architect was. And I mean that completely. I was very intimidated to live up to that. We have fun here. We focus. What I want to say about the last comment really was, in going to see the light shower show at the DuPont-Corian project, I always went to see Yoshiko's work. Somehow I just always thought, like, I need to go see that. So she invited me to come see it, and I went down to the, I guess it was the Javits Center on probably a Sunday afternoon or something like that, and through this huge trade show. And you're kind of going, you know, the stuff that's at trade shows. But I come along and I see light showers, and then I go in, and Yoshiko was sitting on one of the little milled Corian boulders herself with the light going across her. And what I just couldn't believe, she was just sitting there herself, and she was completely in it. And later on, it really struck me, and again, I told David Hinkle this the day I heard she died. I said, you know, she built things for people, but she really built them because she wanted to see if it was possible. And I think that is, like, unbelievably profound, that you want to see if it can be done, and that you will then get through doing that. Not knowing she was ill, like everybody else, I was shocked to find out in February. And I had spoken to her in email countless times in that month before she passed. The last one was a few days earlier, and I teased her, was she enjoying the radiant heat out at Shelter Island? And she wrote back, of course, but she wasn't there, I find out in retrospect. She put in an installation here last spring, Boundless Energy, you'll see it. She was working up until the last minute, and I think what it makes me realize is that she was so generous to us while she was suffering, and she never told us, and she never, that must have made us look so silly with what we thought were problems, that she could be that strong to just let us go on and on with our silliness while she was having real questions. And I agree, I think the space studio was about learning about the next steps, Yoshiko. I think that's exactly what happened, and it makes all the sense in the world now. Anyway, it's too long. We all here adored working with her, and you're gonna hear from quite a few of us now. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Robert Marino. I was Yoshiko's colleague since she began here at Columbia, and then for a relatively long interlude at the GSD, thanks to Yoshiko. And one thing I can tell you is that there were many commuters at the GSD from New York, and she was a person I would look for in the US Air terminal when we were all very tired coming back to New York. And I was always delighted by seeing her and talking to her and hearing what she had to say, which was always very beautiful and oblique and uplifting at that time of day. I want to tell you about, I think, Yoshiko's last day as a teacher here, which was the beginning of this semester. She was our studio coordinator for the year. And as Michael pointed out, many of us had our own petty concerns, and I had my petty concern. My petty concern was, I said, Yoshiko, I've had these students three semesters in a row. I'm very concerned. I don't think I'm going to get any students. And she was obviously not feeling well at this time, yet she looked at me and said, Bob, relax, it's going to be fine. Just make your presentation and let's see what happens. And she was right, as you would expect. In any case, I was astounded by her presence that day, which was mid-September. She was obviously very weak. She couldn't stand during her presentation. And what I remember was, more than anything else, not sadness, not regret, not anything except a kind of frustration that she could not physically do what she really wanted to do and felt like she had to do. And she nonetheless proceeded through her presentation, and I said to her at the end, I said, are you okay? Do you need help? And she said, well, yeah, please help me get to a cab. and that was pretty much it. I took her out to Amsterdam Avenue and looked at her, and she looked at me, and I said, "Goodbye, I hope you feel better." And so I wrote Michael a letter saying that I shared something with her. We were not by any means close friends in the conventional sense, except I think we shared some strange aesthetic. And I don't mean we liked the same shapes or forms or colors. There was something about the way she conducted herself with students and colleagues, and even in my studio when I would invite her, that was very spiritual, that was one dimension, and very pointed. She could elicit criticism in an oblique way, in a very beautiful way. And I will miss that very much, and I hope she rests in peace.
My name is Scott Marble, and I'm also part of this group of faculty that had the opportunity to teach with Yoshiko for probably the last 10 years or so. And some of my fondest memories of Yoshiko center around the many years of just spending an afternoon in this room next door where we would all get together and present our studio lotteries. And I remember the first time that I heard Yoshiko present her space studio, and I didn't really know her well at that time, but I knew of her work, you know, much like you've seen, beautiful, minimalist, you know, beautifully articulated interior spaces and installations. But she gave this presentation, and she was going to the moon. And I thought, what is she up to, you know? I mean, there are a lot of crazy things that happen around this school, but I think we all looked at each other, and we just kind of said, wow. What's going on here? But I can distinctly remember that a smile came across my face. And I looked at the other critics, and they were also smiling. And these were smiles of just curiosity and kind of admiration. But it was clear that this was a very serious endeavor. As clips of 1960s sci-fi movies, humorous ads for space travel flashed across the screen, Yoshiko laid out a compelling vision for why architects needed to extend their imagination to include design in space. And in one of her many kind of provocations, she described space exploration as allowing one to go halfway to anywhere. And when I read that again recently, it just kind of dawned on me. It's like, wow, you know, you could spend your life thinking about that. So over the many years of her ongoing research, the vision got grander, more focused. The presentations that she gave in that room next door became more engaging. The moon became boring, so she moved on to Mars. And the work produced by the students became increasingly accomplished. I mean, it was quite amazing, the work that would come out of the studio. One of the last times that I heard Yoshiko speak about her work on space was in Japan. It was a conference at the Morris Foundation in Tokyo, and it was it included presentations from some of the largest companies in Japan doing huge projects, large visionary projects around Japan. And in hindsight, there are two things that were special about that particular event. The first was that after all those incredible presentations being done by large industry, Yoshiko got up. And her calm, confident manner, she trumped everyone. She outdid everybody and laid out a challenge that truly caught everybody by surprise. The second, more important thing about that day was that Yoshiko's mother was in the audience and got a chance to experience what we here, the faculty, the students, had the opportunity to experience for all those years, seeing her present her work. And I can only imagine how special that was for both of them. There have been many emotions and memories that have drifted through this school this semester. And as I reflect on the many times that we sat in that room next door listening to Yoshiko's evolving vision of life beyond Earth, it occurs to me that those memories are tied to the smiles that still come across our faces when we think of Yoshiko.
I'm Carla Rothstein. Yoshiko and I were on each other's first round jury list, negotiating dates at the start of each term to make an exchange feasible. We were especially pleased to inherit one another's former students, a recent review having simultaneously served as a mutual interview for future potential. I believe Yoshiko viewed learning as both a highly individual and a social act. She sought and offered specific, instigative critique attuned to effectively reach a particular personality, context, or learning style. Avery Hall will serve as an enduring memory site for the dedication to rigorous exploration that Yoshiko's teaching embodied, providing tangible and evolving evidence of the focus and precision that our colleague modeled and inspired in all who were fortunate to be motivated by her. Yoshiko balanced toughness with a warm touch, like an intense soak in steamy, milky white Ofuro waters, gently poised with three bright yellow bobbing lemons. Beyond my great admiration for Yoshiko as a devoted educator, our side conversations returned to two themes: personal disciplines related to nutrition, and snow. We bonded easily over the importance of protein, especially fish and raw egg, to initiate a fine morning. And I will continue to attempt to incorporate natto, pungent yet gossamer fermented soybeans, into my life. As for the crystalline water that sometimes falls from the clouds, in those ephemeral moments when the city is embraced in the poetic silence of snowfall, I will be reminded of Yoshiko's grace and her integrity.
Apple. That was the last word that Yoshiko said directly to me. Apple. It was November 28th of last year, and I was walking into a meeting in room 408 upstairs, a meeting of faculty to decide which students should receive a nomination for internship to the Rienzo Piano Building Workshop. She said that because some days on my way to school, I stop at the Union Square Farmers Market, and I was carrying the bags of apples that I always bring up from there. Some weeks before, when she had seen me carrying them around and teased me about it, because as everyone who knew her knew, when she got to know you, teasing was her form of affection. At that earlier moment, I had given her an apple, and since then, whenever she saw me with the bags, she asked for one. As did Galia and Robert and Laura and Jeffrey Johnson, who was in the room for that meeting. and of course, we all were talking and discussing with Yoshiko the work at hand, which we took very seriously. But apple and that reach, that gesture, was the last personal word from her. Apples, of course, originated in Asia. And the apple I had for her that day was a Fuji, which originated in Japan in the 1930s. But the apple I gave her that first time that made her always want to have an apple from those bags that I cart around was a Macoun, which was developed in upstate New York about a decade early in the 1920s. A Macoun is the very best apple in the world. But it has the shortest season, as did Yoshiko. It's the best apple in the world because it has the perfect mix. It is crisp. And that's Yoshiko's sharpness of the extraordinary work that you'll see on the fourth floor and the extraordinary student work that she inspired and sharpened that made it so fantastic to be on her amazing reviews. It's juicy, full of vital life and poetry the way she was. Sweet, because who was sweeter than our more considerate, our most considerate colleague, Yoshiko? And tart, that sassy teasing that was so endearing. And so with that gesture so full of hunger for what is so good in life, I give you, in honor of Yoshiko and to all of us, apple.
I am Galia Solomonov, and I taught with Yoshiko. About a year ago, April 27, 2011, I attended Yoshiko Sato Space Studio Review across the hall from here, in room 114. Of course, I had no clue that it would be the last space studio we would complete, she would complete. It was a joyous, great afternoon. And the project you are seeing in the screen is the result of that semester work. Tommy Haddock, one of the students in this group, produced this marvelous Zen spaceship. Wiggly was also in the room while Tommy discussed his project. We were delighted by his explanation of morphing gardens, projected environments, and variable iridescent materials, and the confusing line between space here and there. There as a space, not just architecture space, but a space, large space. At one point in the review, the annoying pragmatist in me asked, how long would this trip be? 6 years, Tommy said, with the calm assertion of someone who had overcome his own doubts and given in entirely to Yoshiko's teaching experience. 6 years, I repeated in disbelief. That's a lifetime. Yeah, said Yoshiko, arching her eyebrows, happy. Yoshiko loved space. Yoshiko was adventurous. She embodied her parents' scientific and artistic dreams. She was modest, and I must say that I learned about most of her earlier success in her obituaries. The only clue I had of her importance as a student and her effect in her colleagues earlier was by the assertion of Diana Agres, who remind her own students, Yoshiko Sato and Nanako Umemoto were my best students, and I taught a lot of people, she would add. Good teachers like Yoshiko exude authority. Yoshiko never raised her voice or used imperatives. It is difficult for me to tell how her gentle manner resulted in this very strong and affirmative direction that she gave to her students. In reviewing the work at the end of each of those five semesters, it was clear that her studio was capable of producing the most beautiful and imaginative designs than any other. Like Lori, Michael Bell, and Mara Katansky, Yoshiko was part of the group of teachers that taught me how to teach. The word generous feels short and inappropriate to describe Yoshiko, who was always ready to give. She always expressed herself in the suggestion mode. Her suggestions were precise. She would send emails at late hours, and I would get up between feedings, I had a young child then, and find a 3 a.m. email suggesting shortening the exercise 1 week, adding a 1/2 scale section as a deliverable to a list. I always took her suggestions, and invariably, these things made things better. Not just better for me, better for everyone. Yoshiko made things better for everyone. I distinctly remember Yoshiko sitting in the Korean pavilion at the ICFF fair, I think. It was probably 2006 or 2007, that wide undulating box, and Yoshiko in her pleated attire sitting inside. She liked the blouse that I'm wearing today. She was convinced it would make a great building envelope. It's the back. Vertical or horizontally, she said. I agree that she didn't finish her sentences. She would be vertically or horizontally. Tapering the edge or allowing it, maybe becoming shreds, she would say. Yoshiko's passion for architecture and outer space. Space habitation models, NASA, Space Lab, the Space Conference in Moscow, remediating Earth. These were things that came back. Yoshiko was an incomparable teacher, one that could translate her talent as architect into a pedagogy. Yoshiko possessed the traits we admire: kindness, generosity, openness, honesty, understanding, and feeling. Greed and self-interest were totally absent. Yet too often, these are the traits that make success in our culture. And while we admire the quality of the first, sometimes we reward the second. I am here today feeling a sense of debt towards Yoshiko Sato. And from what I heard from you, many of you feel the same way. Yoshiko did not get in the measure she gave to us. The burden of this debt toward her saddens me. It confirms that life is sometimes unfair and that Yoshiko was taken away too soon. Maybe life is unfair. Maybe architecture is unfair. Maybe society is unfair. Or maybe this is just the way things simply are. Maybe because of what I learned from Yoshiko and what we took from her, we will find newer and better ways to give back. Maybe we'll rush to give next time. Maybe giving back is better when it's not given to the person that gave us. Maybe we will give more to the next one in line.
My name is Maya Dillon. I met Yoshiko on December 18th, 2002. She came to me for acupuncture, for pain relief, and stress relief, and over the years became a friend. Cancer for her was not a death sentence, it was a challenge to heal. She worked incredibly hard researching treatments and trying many avenues to healing, all the while maintaining her career and helping her beloved father through his health challenge and ultimately his death. 6 months after I met her, she introduced me to Michael at the opening of the exhibit they had designed for the Museum of Folk Art. A few years later, my mind was blown as I sat on a very sensual Korean egg. And sometime after that, my husband, Kier, and I spent a winter weekend on Shelter Island in awe of what Yoshiko and Michael had created in those beautiful homes there. Yoshiko thought a lot about what she wanted in her life, which already included many things: her design work, teaching, her family, friends, her cat, Luna, and her life partner and love, Michael. But something was missing. She told me she had always wanted a dog, and not a little apartment-sized dog. And remember, this was before the house in Shelter Island. In April of 2003, I have a note in her chart. Sleep difficult because dog is taking up too much space. A very rambunctious Labrador puppy named Sola had become a member of the Morris Sato team. Two of the biggest stress factors in anyone's life are too little space or too little time. Yoshiko experienced both of these, but too little space didn't stop her from making room for Sola, and too little time didn't stop her from creating the life she wanted. I wonder if the concept of space studio came from breaking out of the constraints of this world and seeing the improbable as possible. Yoshiko was a visionary, and it is we who had too little time with her.
My name is Keir DeLay. When I sat down this afternoon and read the program, and reading over the remarks by Mark Wrigley, I realized that they really, in a way, helped introduce the few remarks that I had prepared, particularly when he said, Yoshiko Sato was an expert in the shaping of the beyond. For her, the here and now is not the streets of our ever more dense cities, but the extended vacuum of outer space. The platform for the architectural leap is no longer the earth, but deepest space. I don't remember exactly when I first met Yoshiko and Michael, but it was in Biarritz at the wedding of Kathleen, Michael's sister, that I had the chance to spend quality time with them. I was struck by Yoshiko's quiet depth, like a still pond containing a plethora of vital and unexpected life forms. I had no idea at that time that my area of expertise, acting, would intersect with hers. But out of those depths came an idea, one that would challenge her students beyond gravity and ordinary construction. But Yoshiko was out of the ordinary. She launched Space Studio in 2008 and invited me along. I guess I was the only one she knew who'd been in space in the film 2001: A Space Odyssey, and it was a treat for me to attend the students' review and see where her spark had taken them. Oh, incidentally, watching some of the photographs of her installations, it struck me that were 2001: A Space Odyssey to be refilmed, I would absolutely nominate her to design the sets. We may not know in our lifetimes whether any of those space hotels will be built, but Yoshiko left a lasting legacy for her students and anyone she invited into those depths. Expect the unexpected and attempt the impossible.
I'm Craig Connick. I've known and admired Yoshiko almost as long as I've been in New York. For me, Yoshiko served as a kind of design conscience, a metric of excellence. As a student, she inspired her teachers, and as a teacher, she inspired her students immensely. She never stood still in the pursuit of innovative thinking in her work or her teaching. She brought her fascination with space exploration to her space studio, this year being its sixth mission. It stands as an incredible legacy. In that it is as much about philosophy, sociology, and basic human habitation as it is about space and a mission through it. Michael Morris, who I have to say is an incredible colleague and teacher and equal in so many ways to Yoshiko, and myself, we had the daunting honor of continuing this year's studio to illuminating the lessons of space with her students that she begun this semester. And once again, Yoshiko inspired. She had forged deep and meaningful connections within NASA, traveling each year with her students to Houston to observe firsthand the research and thinking of scientists and engineers who were involved in actual missions. One of them, Pai Filichak, is here, he's there in the photo, is here today with us from Johnson Space Center in Houston, and I'd like to invite him to come up and say a few words.
Hi, my name is Pai Filichak. I'm the aerospace engineer for NASA. I met Yoshiko through my sister-in-law, Brett Gators, who is a student here. It was five missions ago. When I met her, I was the safety and quality engineer for the space station. And then after that, I got moved to space shuttle quality engineer. And now I'm project engineer for the astronaut jetpack. Through the years, my first impression of Yoshiko was when she first came down to Johnson Space Center. You know, she had her student, and she came down, and everyone she met, she'd think we all rocket scientists. And she asked all these tough questions, and we would sit down in a meeting just with her and some of their project manager without a student, and Yoshiko always have an answer that we just look around between our manager and go, how does she know this? I mean, she do a lot more research than we do. She told us that, I guess through her research, she told us that president's gonna cancel the moon mission and we thought that was proprietary. We thought, wait, you shouldn't know this. And and she does. So she said, my student gonna design not just going to the moon this time, we're gonna go to habitat the moon. And we were all in awe, just listening to, she was running the show at NASA. And I wish I had recorded that because it was amazing. Every year she's always have a vision and goal for her student. She's always say, I want to help my student think outside the box, dare them to be creative. And she said, challenge my student when they come down here, you know, ask tough questions and push them as far as we could. And, you know, although I only met Yoshiko, you know, once a year, and it's just been an honor. I felt she's very close to the NASA community. We talk about her. We always looking forward for her to come back down to NASA. I guess, you know, everybody talking up here have the same speech about how great she is, how brilliant she is, how amazing. On the other side, she's pretty brave, actually. One of the sessions she came down, we went all out to dinner, and we had a student, and we had this very scary roller coaster. It's wooden, it's right next to the water, and it's rattling. And she's like, hey, Pa, you should get on there one of these days. It's very scary. And I go, if you're scared, I mean, you know, I'm scared of that. How can you not be scared? But she just know how to touch people. Like we talked about her every year again at NASA. We just, like, she's one of our own. We just say, hey, when is Yoshiko and her student coming down? And although I got transferred to a different program, and my the NASA manager that she dealt with, Dr. David Fitt, all those project manager always asked me, hey, can you continue this collaboration with Columbia University? This is really such a great outreach program. And personally, it's an honor for me to be a part of that. And I learned a lot from her. I learned that anything you can put your mind to it, you can achieve, because that's what she does. She tells us to, she tells her students to, her vision and her student able to capture that and run with it. It's amazing. Every year we see something that's out of this world, you know, like some of her design, we felt like, hey, can we get on, you know, can you guys come build us this spaceship or this habitat? It was that good. So, again, and thank you for inviting me, and it's an honor for me to be here.
Hi, we have a short video we're going to play before we speak.
Do you want to go to space?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
Absolutely.
You're sure about it?
We're definitely going to space.
I hope so.
I don't think we will.
Why not?
I mean, us?
Yeah.
The layperson? Do you consider yourself a layperson?
Yes.
Oh. As far as space travel is concerned, yes.
From Yoshiko's studio. She always asked her students to spend the first 2 days of her studio putting together what their concept of space was. So we compiled a few of those into a short video for you guys. I'm Kelsey Lenz. I was one of her students in the space studio. We're all former students of hers, and I've TA'd for her studios since having her as a professor. I'm gonna speak a little bit first about her as professor, and then we'll also speak about the space studio in particular. In grad school, you always have a list of what you'd like to take away from your studio and your professor each semester. The list goes on, and it's much of what the list had on it when you signed up for grad school. What isn't on that list, though, what's too rare to find its way onto any checklist, is mentorship. I would talk about how lucky I was to have that relationship with her, but I think if you asked any of the students in her studios, they would all say that they had had an amazing relationship with her, and that she had an incredible ability to connect with her studio. She had a profound influence on all of her students. That's what's truly incredible about Yoshiko. It wasn't luck to say that you'd found a mentor in her. It was simply Yoshiko. People often talk about a professor's passion for teaching. Yoshiko certainly had that. But even more, what the students felt was her passion for them in particular, for their work specifically. It isn't often that a student finds themselves on the same sleep schedule as their professor. But in Yoshiko's studio, I can't count the number of times we'd be working at 3 a.m., and our only company would be the ping in our inbox. And a message from Yoshiko would appear, a link to an article she thought one of us would like, or to research she'd found on our project. And if she was up working on her project, how could we not be? It was this devotion to her students that inspired us to produce our best work for her. Her belief not in any clock during studio hours, but in reaching resolution. A desk crit wasn't over until you'd hit a breakthrough. I remember one desk crit in particular. The two of us were at a bit of a crossroads in my project, and she sat with me, and sat with me, and sat with me, for about 45 minutes, primarily in silence, until one of us could figure out what we should say about my project. And eventually, we hit on something. How rare is it to find a professor who so innately believes not only that if the student just worked hard enough, but if she worked hard enough with them, every project could be something great.
So what you witnessed on the screen, I'm Christina Chardua on Space Studio 3, and I'm honored to be here to speak about Yoshiko. What you witnessed on the screen was a sampling of our 6 years of work, and especially that first assignment where she asked us all to tell us what our vision was for the future. She wanted to know immediately what was our dream. And this is only born of someone who has her own vision and her own dream. And this is nothing, there's nothing a professor can do more to inspire her students than to be so optimistic and passionate about the work. Yoshiko's vision was sincere and joyful and innocent. And the drive was insatiable and her dreams were unbounded. And as a professor, she sought that out and brought that out in each of us. She believed we could be exceptional and made us so. She believed that architecture had a beautiful place in our worlds and other worlds' futures. And she inspired within each of us the same drive to achieve whatever we envisioned that future to be, to allow us as architects to take an active role in shaping not only this world, but the universe. This was done without pretense, without agenda, with nothing other than pure and driven heart and will as rough as nails. You couldn't say no to Yoshiko, though after our studio triple-coated an exhibition space in black paint, someone apparently said no. I remember a colleague of mine, after working proudly for weeks, presented her his work, and she said simply no. Anyway... All this to say, this is what inspires us, inspires the best within us as students.
Hi, I'm Ji-young Kim, and I'm also her student, and also I was her TA. Also, we worked together for the lab. So I just want to say thank you to Michael to allow us to share this moment with everybody. And I met Yoshiko in 2007. She was my professor. I can't agree more than what Christina and Kelsey said. I've been through all of that too. And also Yoshiko was one of the most motivated and focused people I've ever met. I wanted to mention that it has been 5 years, but everything I learned from her, it is still with me and it is part of me. One of the lessons she taught me in the class was, do not lose your initial ideas. And be true to your concept. I found myself always going back to that lesson, even now.
I wanted to speak a little bit about Space Studio. I was Space Studio 3, as I mentioned, which was the final year in low Earth orbit. She was becoming an expert and knew faulty or lazy research when she saw it. She constantly called us out on the amount of solar panels we would have or our radiation shielding techniques. She was getting ready to move on to the moon and beyond at that point. The vision she had for Space Studio was one that incorporated both the most fantastical and the most strikingly real of our abilities. Space Studio brought everything into question. It shook your reality and made you come to terms with what it really means to be living in a built environment, and only a built environment. The constraints were monumental, and as the years passed, she began to add more and more technical knowledge and more technical voices to our conversation. Engineers, space scientists, all became an integral part of the studio. We were in serious talks with NASA, and every year we gathered more and more colleagues at NASA to join us in conversation. This was not just a visionary studio, a studio about a distant fantasy. It was real and grounded. It combined the very best of both worlds, because this was real, as real for Yoshiko as it was for us, and yet inspired the most creative visions for the world that you could imagine. We needed to know not only how large a radius created 1G, but what was the society that we were creating. We needed to know what plants we were going to take with us, just how we were going to prevent bone loss, what methods were we researching to improve psychological health on long-duration missions in tight quarters, and how we were going to do all this within the fantastical universe we created while dreaming about life and existence and taking us out of ourselves to think about the infinite.
Yoshiko started Space Studio in 2007, and I was actually one of the first Space Studio students. It was the start of a very unique studio, and I learned what it takes to do something never done before. But it was also equally exciting too, because of the same reason. Yoshiko worked really hard to make our NASA trip to happen. It was the first time for all of us, and the presentation, tours, and the whole experience at NASA was extremely inspiring. Scientists and space architects at NASA were fascinated and motivated by her and Space Studio's work, and the relationship with NASA continued. I also worked with Yoshiko for 2008 Beijing Olympic opening ceremony outfit design. I can't forget, it was the summer I worked for Kala. I got a call from Yoshiko. She was really, really excited. And I worked for her during the day. I worked for Yoshiko at night. It was a really fun summer. Okay. So when we got the project, during the Space Studio, we did a lot of research about human behaviors in the extreme environment and associated technologies. Olympic was like a chance to us, and it was an egress for us to let our ideas to go. It is transformed into the creations within the most imaginary setting it could ever be. Yoshiko took a way of thinking and applied to the other fields. Also, during this multidisciplinary project, she always put emphasis on professional collaborations and the respect.
So we've talked a lot about Yoshiko's excitement for outer space, and I think one of the most incredible things about her space studio is that she took students who, some of whom already had an excitement for outer space and some of whom who didn't know that much about space to begin with, and made them as excited about it as she was. So while I'm wrapping up, we have one final slideshow that has images from all of our trips to Houston, and you can see kind of what world she brought to her students that I don't think you would get in any other studio.
Yes.
So while that's coming up, for Yoshiko's students, her passion played out in space. It wasn't just the idea of outer space that excited her, which obviously did. She would have been first in line for a trip to the moon or Mars, and her name's probably on a list somewhere already. But what was incredible, what was so visionary about her studio and about her belief in outer space, was how intertwined she realized the world of space and architecture could be. By the time I took the studio, it was already in its fifth year, and she had taken what started out as an experiment and made it an established reality. We had people from every industry, from robotics, from engineering, from structure. We had people from every city, from California, from Houston, from New York, and by the time she got the astronauts involved, we had from different planets as well. And they took part in all of our crits and presentations. They came in for reviews. And what is so incredible about her relationship with people and her effect on people was that once you became involved with Yoshiko, or once you became involved with the studio, you stayed involved. It was in part her belief that space architecture could inspire what happened here on the ground, but it was also that she believed that the way we think as architects about space could influence what's developed at NASA and in space beyond. She truly believed that in collaborating and merging the way we think, there was potential for a new kind of architecture, a new kind of living. That was what Space Studio was truly about, and that was the foundation of the NASA-Columbia collaboration that she worked so hard to create. She'd started an internship over the summer for her students, and it was because she really believed that the research wasn't something to be lost entirely to the academic realm, that it was to be started there and fostered and then it was to be taken out for test runs and for trials, that the collaboration she started in the studio should be continued on in the summer and after graduation. It's a rare opportunity that she set up for us, the chance to combine theoretical and fantastical concepts with its practical and applied counterpart. Over the summer, I worked at NASA over the summer, and I often had to pinch myself because student academic work is so liberating and the freedom that it gives you to experiment. But what's so incredible about her studio and her internship program and about her teaching in general was that it was liberating and the freedom that it gave you to live out your experiments. I think we'll all really miss Yoshiko, and we're all really blessed to have had her as a professor.
Wow. We've run a little bit over time here. Thanks for everybody for your beautiful comments and words. I just want to end with a quote that Yoshiko also always used in her presentation. Because she certainly thought that an architect should join this crew. We're also announcing with Columbia the Sato Space Architecture Fund, which is at Yoshiko's behest that we continue her teaching legacy here at the school by offering some money every year to a student who wish to intern or do some project relative to space exploration, and I'm happy to announce that today. Thank you all for coming, and please join us for the reception upstairs. We have one more parting Irish goodbye, and perhaps we should have had some whiskey in here today, but we'll have some vodka upstairs, Yoshiko's drink of choice, so please join us.
I want to thank you all for coming today. I just wanted to pick up on Michael's anecdote about the custodian's reaction to their exhibition. I have to say that in the 30 years I've worked at GSAPP, I've never seen a reaction like those I've seen in response to the exhibit on the fourth floor that you're going to see. And this is whether it's from me or from the UPS delivery man, the administrative assistant who is not an architect, and yes, actually the custodian. The show upstairs has elicited wonder and delight from everyone who has seen it, and it's touched everyone. So I want to say thank you for that, Michael, and thank you, Yoshiko.
We have one more slide, because everybody will just be patient. Just we have one more thing. So this will be our parting glass.
In this heart lies for you a lark born only for you, who sings only to you, my love. My love, my love.
My love, my love, my love.